Great to see you all here this morning. And if you want to turn in your Bibles, please, to John chapter 20. We're going to start in verse 11. Get straight into the Word of God this morning. And the message today is entitled, A Better Story. That's a simple title, but hopefully the message will unpack that in a little bit of detail for you. And it's a message that is directed at each one of you as individuals about God's better stories. But let's start in John chapter 20, verse 11. I'm going to read through to verse 18. And it says, Now Mary stood outside the tomb crying. As she wept, she bent over to look into the tomb and saw two angels in white seated where Jesus' body had been, one at the head and the other at the foot. And they asked her, Woman, why are you crying? It's a little bit like they know the story, don't they? They know the better story already, and they're not upset because they know that Jesus is alive. But she says, They have taken my Lord away, and I don't know where they have put him. And at this, she turned around and saw Jesus standing there, but she did not realize that it was Jesus. And he asked her, Woman, why are you crying? Who is it you are looking for? Thinking that he was the gardener, she said, Sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you have put him, and I will get him. And Jesus said to her, Mary. And she turned toward him and cried out in Aramaic, Rabboni, which means teacher. And Jesus said, Do not hold on to me, for I have not yet ascended to the Father. Go instead to my brothers and tell them, I am ascending to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God. Mary Magdalene went to the disciples with the news, I have seen the Lord. And she told them that he had said these things to her. And so Jesus is alive, and we celebrate that today. But Mary doesn't know that. She ends up going to look for Jesus' body to kind of prepare it a little bit more to take care of it. But she gets there and the stone has been rolled away and the body of Jesus is gone. But what I want to focus on is what Jesus says. He says to her, Go and tell my brothers. Go and tell them that I'm alive. And it's like he says to Mary, Go and tell the disciples that there's a better story. Because imagine what the disciples are feeling. They've journeyed with Jesus for about 3 years. They followed him. They've left everything to pursue him and to learn from him. Yet 3 days before he was on the cross dying, a painful death. Everything that they'd hoped for was there on the cross, dying away. How would you have felt? Were they somewhere else, depressed, feeling hopeless? I'm sure they were to a degree. Were they fearful in case the authorities also came after them and did the same thing to them that they'd done to Jesus? Were they angry? Were they questioning God? God, why have you let this happen? You promised so much. Yet Jesus says, Go and tell them that there's a better story. Go and tell them that the story isn't over. The better one has just begun. And so this morning I want to look at that. The truth that a better story has started for each one of us. That because of Easter, because of what we celebrate today, there is a better story and a better life for us to live. I don't know how each one of you as individuals feels about life. I know some of your stories, I don't know all of them. I know some of your previous stories and how life has been challenging and difficult. I don't know your story, I don't know your life, but Jesus knows. I don't know what you feel about Jesus this morning, whether or not you're exploring, just questioning whether or not he's real. Or you're a stalwart in the Christian faith. You've been journeying with Jesus for years. But whatever situation we find ourselves in, whichever position you're in, there's a better story for each one of us. If you don't know Jesus, there's a better story for you to discover for the first time. And if you do know Jesus, there's a better story for you to keep seeing written in your life and seeing unfolding into even greater things than you can ever hope for or imagine. And why is there a better story? It's more than just Easter, isn't it? Easter is just an event. It's just a one-time event that we look back upon and celebrate. But Easter points to a generous and loving God A God who so loved the world that he sent his only son to die for us. A God who so loved us that he was prepared to write a better story for us to live a different life. He's so good. And you might be thinking, oh, they're talking about God in the personal way like that. It's a bit weird. But when you know him, you can't help but talk about him in the way that declares your love for him. Because as a Christian, you can know God. That is the better story. The better story is knowing Jesus. And God's always been like that. And I want to look at just very quickly a couple of examples in Scripture where we see God writing a better story for someone's life. And then I want to look at it from our perspective. What does it mean for us here today? Because the Bible is living, it's active. It's not just a book, it's a book that changes your life. It transforms you from the inside out. So when we read these stories, they've got to be doing something in our hearts. It's not just information, but like the old saying goes, it's transformation. And so if you want to turn to Genesis chapter 12, we meet a guy called Abram, who becomes in the end Abraham. God gives him a new name as part of his better story. But in this chapter, he's still Abram. And we're going to read from verses 1 to 4. And the Lord had said to Abram, go from your country, your people and father's household to the land I will show you. I will make you into a great nation and I will bless you. I will make your name great and you will be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you and whoever curses you, I will also curse. And all peoples on earth will be blessed through you. And so Abram went as the Lord had told him. And again, we don't quite know what's going through Abraham's mind there. He's living with his family. He's got his mind probably on his part of his father's inheritance because he knows his father's pretty wealthy. He's got animals, which is a sign of wealth. There'll be property in that town. It's his hometown. And so he thinks he's got a story to unfold in the future. He thinks he's got a story maybe when his dad passes away, he'll become the patriarch of the family and be the one that is honoured and have the wealth. But God had a better story for him. Abraham thought he was getting this, but God was always going to give him that, which was far better, far greater than he can ever hope for or imagine. He wasn't just going to inherit his father's camels or his father's goats or whatever it was that he was going to inherit. He was going to inherit the nations. He was going to inherit a whole nation that was born out of him. And I don't know if God has ever said anything to you that it's been so amazing you just couldn't believe it. Or there's promises in your life and you're thinking there's no way God could do that. But I want to say that God can do it. Amen. Because his story is always a better story. Amen. But Abraham had a choice. He could have ignored God. He could have said, you know what, actually this looks, my lot in life already is quite good. I've got an inheritance coming. I want to play it safe so that when my dad passes away, I'm around to get it. And live my life as I want to live it. But I think there's something in Abraham that's hungry for more. Maybe he's dissatisfied. And when God calls him to leave his family and to go to somewhere that's unknown, doesn't quite know where he's going, he takes that step of faith and he goes. He could have had a limited story. He could have made his own story out of his own life. But instead he steps into God's better story, which ultimately has become our better story. And we see it again with Moses, who's one of the most famous guys in the Bible. There's plenty of films about Moses, isn't there? There's the Charlton Heston one, who I always love that bit when he's gone up to the Mount Sinai and he comes down and it looks like he's had a real good hair wash and a bit of a blow dry, and his face, you know, he's got a bit of fake tan on because he's seen God. He just radiates something better than he did at the foot of the mountain. It's like he's had a shower up there and God said, like, let's sort your hair out because it looks a right mess. But he's seen God. That bouffant is blowing in the wind. But Moses, again, is someone who thinks he's got a better story. He is an Israelite. He's a Jew, but he gets brought up in the Pharaoh's court because when Pharaoh goes to murder the Jewish children, his mum sends him off down the Nile. And he gets taken in by one of Pharaoh's daughters and he gets raised in the court. And so Moses thinks he's got a royal story, that he's in the household of God. The household of Pharaoh is wealthy, he's a leader, he's got authority. But again, that was not God's better story. And there's something that Moses does in his life that derails his own story. He knows that he's an Israelite, and he sees an Egyptian guard mistreating one of the Israelite slaves, but making bricks or whatever it is that they're doing at the time. And Moses murders the Egyptian guard, and people notice that, they see that he's done that, and then he legs it to the desert for 40 years. But it's like something in Moses' life began to leak into his story. It's like something that was hidden in him, in his story that he hadn't seen before, began to leak in and derail things. And have you ever been in that position where you thought life was all right, that you were doing okay, that you were pretty good, that God had sorted you out, but then certain parts of your character flare up under pressure and things begin to derail again? Or something from your past comes back to bite you, and you're thinking, I thought I dealt with that, but it comes back. The thing is, God can still make a better story out of that. Nothing can derail God's story apart from you choosing to ignore the call that he puts upon your life. So Moses goes off into the desert, and we pick it up in Exodus 3 from verse 4. And he's out being a shepherd. So he's gone from the royal household to being a shepherd looking after the sheep. He's in a place called Midian, and he's got married, he's got kids. And one day, out of nowhere, he notices that there's this bush that just keeps on burning. And now a burning bush is not unusual because of the dry desert and the heat. Bushes could catch fire, but they always burnt out. But this bush is keeping burning. So he goes over to explore, and we pick it up in verse 4. And it says, when the Lord saw that Moses had gone over to look, God called to him from within the bush. Moses, Moses, that would have been a bit weird, wouldn't it? Moses, can you imagine it? Richard, Rich from one of your golf clubs. Richard, Richard. Well, from the golf hole, it's the hole, it starts talking at you and spits your ball back out saying you play too much golf. And Moses said, here I am. I'm here, obviously, because God saw you. And God says, do not come any closer. Take off your sandals, for the place where you are standing is holy ground. And then he said, I am the God of your father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. And at this, Moses hid his face because he was afraid to look at God. And the Lord said, I have indeed seen the misery of my people in Egypt. I have heard them crying out because of their slave drivers, and I am concerned about their suffering. So I have come down to rescue them from the hand of the Egyptians and to bring them up out of that land into a good and spacious land, a land flowing with milk and honey, the home of the Canaanites, the Hittites, the Amorites, the Perizzites, Hivites, and Jebusites. And now the cry of the Israelites has reached me, and I have seen the way the Egyptians are oppressing them. So now go. I am sending you to Pharaoh to bring my people, the Israelites, out of Egypt. So Moses had thought he'd derailed his best story. He thought he'd left behind maybe what was better, and he was living a simple life, a quiet life. He wasn't a leader. He wasn't leading sheep. But God still called him into a better story. And God might have thought that his chances of impacting a nation was over, but God had really been working on his heart. For those 40 years, something of Moses' heart had been softened. Maybe the pride and the arrogance of royalty had been knocked out of him a little bit. Maybe the dreams of something more than just looking after sheep had begun to rise up again. So when God times it right and calls him to rescue a nation out of Egypt, Moses, again, like Abraham, makes the choice to say yes and steps into God's better story, which, a little bit like Abraham was promised, you're going to be a blessing. Moses' yes became a blessing for the Israelites in Egypt, didn't it? He could have said no, and what would have happened? Because Moses was so well placed to impact the Egyptian authorities, he'd been part of the household. He would have been remembered and recognized. He, in some way, still carried a little bit of authority because of his history. Who else was better to get into the throne room of Pharaoh and to command him to release the Israelites? If Moses had said no, what would have happened? The better story for the Israelites maybe wouldn't have happened as quite as quickly as it did do. And we've all got stories that we're living in. We've all got personal journeys with or without God. But it can be a lesser story if God isn't number one in our lives. The Bible tells us this in Isaiah 53. It says that we all, like sheep, have gone astray. Each of us has turned to our own way. And that is the story of humanity, that humanity has lost the sight of God. That humanity has turned away from God and pursued themselves, pursued things that are created more than the Creator. And I was what Brian and Janine, Nicola's mum and dad, are here this morning, and they were farmers, and they still live surrounded by farm fields. And one day we were walking up past one of the fields, and we noticed this big lump of wool just lying there, like a big blob of wool. And Nicola and his sister informed me it was a sheep that had fallen on its back and it couldn't get up. Because sheep are really stupid. And they are. If they get out of the field, out of the pen, they'll just wander anywhere, and they'll try and get their heads through barbed wire to get grass on the other side. Although there's grass right there, they'll go, that just looks better, a bit like a human, isn't it? Oh, it's always better the other side of the fence, isn't it? And they're stupid. And we had to roll this big fat sheep because it had begun to fill up with fluid. And the disgusting thing is, which I didn't know until that time, is they can fill up so much that they can explode. And I'd rather pick it up now than later on, really, because we'll have to like pick it up with a bit of spoon or something like that and dig around. But I was quite scared of the sheep because I don't really do animals, so I bought a dog. I don't really do animals, and I was like trying to roll it with my foot like that. But this sheep doesn't try and give you a helping hand, it just looks at you. And what a picture of humanity. God is trying to help, and we just look up and say, what are you doing? But Easter is about God's help coming down and rolling us off our backs so that we don't explode ourselves and die helpless. What a great image that is, isn't it? If you don't know God, you're going to blow up. You're going to explode. You're going to go everywhere, man. Everywhere. Isaiah 59 verse 3 says, put it like this, that if it's your sins that have cut you off from God, it's not God's fault that you don't know him. It's not God's fault that your life is a mess. It's not God's fault that you're hopeless and lost, because he's created a story for you to step into, which is a better story. That passage tells me that if God is distant, it's my fault. It's my sins that make me distant from God. If you don't know Jesus and you're thinking, oh, surely he's just a part of an imagination, it's not God's fault, it's your fault. All you have to do is turn to God and you discover him in his goodness, in his greatness. It's like you finally get off your back as that sheep and you see things in clear perspective. But sheep are always safer in the fenced off area. They're always safer in the hands of a shepherd or a farmer. And they might think, oh yeah, but there's freedom out on the road. Look at the motorway from the fields. It's all those cars, those vehicles, they're just going wherever they please. Now I'm stuck in this fence. So unfair. But if that sheep gets out of that fence and gets on the motorway, it ain't going to last very long, is it? And that's the same thing with God. God has put boundaries in our life to follow. But the field that he's made for us is always the better field. It's always got the greater grass to eat from. It might look tempting out of the field, but don't give up on God if you're a Christian. You might be here today thinking, God, you seem so distant. We're here to help as pastors. There's always a reason why God is distant, and it's never his fault. And so press on in. If you don't know Jesus today and you think he's just a myth and we're just nuts that celebrate a mystical story from 2,000 years ago, he's real. He's changed my life. There's so many people here whose lives have been changed by Jesus because he invites us into that better story. And Isaiah 59 goes on. It says this in verse 16. So it says, it's your sins that have cut you off from God. And you jump forward a little bit to verse 16. And it says this about God. This is the God who's jumping into your field to roll you off your back. It says that he saw that there was no one. He was appalled that there was no one to intervene. So his own arm achieved salvation for him. And his own righteousness sustained him. So what we could never do ourselves, God has jumped in and done on our behalf. It's his arm that has reached down and rescued us. It's his own life that he nailed to the cross and saw slip away. because he wanted to invite us into his better story. And Ephesians 2, verses 1 to 5 puts it like this. He says, as for you, and this is each one of us, Christian or not yet a Christian, Ephesians 2 puts it like this. As for you, you were dead in your transgressions and sins, in which you used to live when you followed the ways of this world and of the ruler of the kingdom of the air, the spirit who is now at work in those who are disobedient. All of us also lived among them at one time, gratifying the cravings of our flesh and following its desires and thoughts. Like the rest, we were by nature deserving of wrath. But because of his great love for us, God, who is rich in mercy, made us alive with Christ, even when we were dead in transgressions. It is by grace that you have been saved. There's nothing we could ever do to get right with God. God had to do it himself. And Jesus was God. He was not just some guy that God picked on and said, you're going to suffer for the people, you're going to suffer for everyone. But God himself said, I'm going to go down and I'm going to sort it. John 3:16, the most famous passage in the whole Bible, says that God so loved the world that he sent his only son, that whoever would believe in him would not perish, but would have everlasting life. Or you could put it like this, that God so loved the world that he sent Jesus to write a better story. And Jesus today is always the better story. And what part do you play in this story? What is your role in God's overarching story? Because like it or not, we're all part of it. He's the creator of all things. He sustains all things by the power of his word. Christ is in all things. He's in the atoms that sustain life. He's in the wind. He's in nature. He's everywhere. And what is your part in the story? There's only one author of life. There's only one true author of the better story. We can be people that try and write our own stories. You might even be a Christian and you've given your life to Jesus years ago or even recently, yet you're trying to write your own lines. You're in God's story, but the chapter you're in at the moment, you're trying to write it yourself. And God may be saying to you today, stop writing your own story. Let me write it on your heart. Let me work in your situation. Let me give you my wisdom and my guidance and my truth. Because the first thing we often give up on when life is tough is Jesus. Like we stop coming to church, which is just crazy. I've had a bad week, pastor, so I'm not coming to church. You just want to slap him and say, get into church, because in the presence of God is where you need to be. You don't hide away until you sort your life out, get back in your cave, lie on your back again until you start to bloat. You know, get yourself in church because God wants to sort your life out. Maybe you're not a Christian and your life, you've always written it yourself, but it's never quite penned the way you wanted it to. Maybe you've run a little bit out of ink and thinking, what do I do next? Or maybe you've written it saying, it was never meant to end like this. Or why did I write it like that? Why did I make that choice? God today can pull you straight into his better story. He can pull you straight into chapter 21, right in the middle of it, as though your story never existed. And so give Jesus a chance today if you don't know him. He wants to rescue you off your back. It says this in Romans 8. For those who are led by the Spirit of God are the children of God. The Spirit you received does not make you slaves so that you live in fear again. Rather, the Spirit you received brought about your adoption to sonship, and by him we cry, Abba, Father. And the Spirit himself testifies with our spirit that we are God's children. That is the best story you could ever know, being a child of God, knowing his presence in your life, knowing his love, knowing that you can be sorted out on the inside, knowing Jesus personally, being able to sing songs like we do this morning, and it actually means something. And it changes something, that we don't leave this place the same as when we came in. We're sons of God. We've got authority to make this world a better place. And there's so many good people doing so many good things. But it's only God's better story that's ever going to prevail. The Bible says that everything else, even our best efforts, are like chaff, it's like wheat. When the fire of God comes in the end, it's just going to burn away. There's nothing good apart from what God wants to create in us and through us. And I'm sure he's working in so many good things that we don't know of, but the Bible only promises a better story for those who step into God's story. And so to just quickly bring some application to this, before the band come back up. So who are you in the story? Who are you in the story? You could be like Abraham. Maybe God is pulling at your heart. Maybe God has been calling your name for a while. Maybe he's put people in your life that he's put there on purpose to pull you into his better story, to say, look, there's something more for you to live. There's something better for you to discover. Your story doesn't have to keep writing itself or writing the way that it's going. Maybe there's things that he's calling you to leave behind to step into him. And I've met people before who they kind of believe in Jesus, but they say, yeah, but I'm not ready yet to become a Christian. I want to still have this in my life. I still want to be able to sleep with my girlfriend. I still want to be able to do the drugs on a weekend. I still want to be able to watch what I watch on the internet. I still want my story being written. I'm not yet ready for God's story. But like Abraham, he's calling you and he's knocking on your heart saying, look, there's things you're doing that is only leading to death. There's a way that seems wise to men, but the end is death. But God always leads to life. There's no better story without Jesus. He's 100% faithful. He's 100% reliable. Anything else you put your trust in, whether it's money or your own intelligence or your looks, your career, your family, your friends, the car that you drive to give you a bit of a status, none of that compares to Jesus. All that can fade away. You wake up one morning and see a wrinkle on your face thinking it's ending. It's going, my beautiful looks. No offense to anyone, I've got wrinkles. Looks go. Your car rusts. Your jobs, you might get fired, but in the end you retire. So if your status is all in your work, what becomes of you when you retire? But in God's story, you never retire because you live for eternity, doing things with God and for God. Or secondly, are you like Moses? Have you messed up a little bit in life thinking, actually, I've just derailed everything because what was hidden has come to the surface and bitten me on the ankle or somewhere more painful? Or maybe there's a situation that you got yourself in by choice or a relationship that you got involved in it and it's just caused pain. You're thinking, God, I can never get back on your story. Maybe you were called one time for ministry and you're thinking, actually, I've derailed this. I've made certain choices or I've gone so far away that I can't possibly be used by God. Let me tell you today, God can use anyone. He used a donkey to talk to a prophet. He can use any donkey in this room because God simply wants you to be available. No matter your status, no matter what mess you're currently working through, invite God into it. Let him use you because you can still discover life, and that life is what leads you out of the mess that you find yourself in. It was David who said that God has pulled him out of the mire, out of the pit, and set his feet on a rock. I'm sure then his feet were still dirty, yet he was in a position to start to get cleaned up. And so you could be like Moses. Let the author of life rewrite your story. Let him get his penmanship back in your life. Let him rub away a bit of your ink with his, only his pen can rub away some of your story. Let him rewrite your story. Or finally, maybe you're just thriving with God and that is brilliant. Maybe you're going on like you want to, you know, you've hit a season in life where God is closer than anything else. He's closer than your own skin. Maybe you've hit a season in life where whatever you pray for is being answered. Or you're seeing people come to faith because you're sharing about Jesus. Maybe that's brilliant and that is fantastic. Let's celebrate that. But don't let Jesus become out of focus. Don't get so wrapped up in the things that you're doing that you forget about the person of Jesus. Because without Jesus, there is no better story. Your activity for God is not the better story. That's part of the better story. When we went out yesterday and did healing on the streets and we were telling people about Jesus and praying for people, that wasn't the better story. That was part of the better story. That was a word within the story. The better story is Jesus and his love, his life, because he's so good, we get to spend eternity with him. How cool is that? It's not just for now. It's not just something that we cling to on a Sunday to make us feel good about ourselves. But he's with us 24/7, and he'll be with us for eternity. Jesus said this to his disciples. They come back and they say, Lord, we've been praying for the demons. They've been legging it out of people. We've been praying for the sick, and they've been getting sorted out. And Jesus says, don't celebrate the stuff that you're doing in my name, but celebrate the fact that your name is written in the book of life. Celebrate the fact that your name is written in my book, that you have a relationship with me, that you are saved and you are restored. That is what you celebrate. Anything else has to flow out of that. We don't please God by doing the stuff. There's people in the book of Acts who are going around casting out demons and healing the sick, but the demons turn on them, rip all the clothes off, beat them up, and they leg it. The seven sons of Sheva. Like, they're doing the stuff, but that doesn't please God. It's not about doing the stuff. It's about knowing the author of life, letting him write our story. And so if George can come up and just play gently on the keys, and the band come up in just a little while, the rest of the band. It says this in 2 Corinthians 5:17. It says that, therefore, if anyone is in Christ, the new creation has come. The old is gone, the new is here. Or fitting in line with the theme of this message, it could say that if anyone has a relationship with Jesus, the old story has gone and a new and better story is being written. And so cling to that hope that Jesus is rewriting your story. As a Christian, there's always a better story. There's more to come. Even if your body is failing, there's still more to come, because there's always more of Jesus to discover. He's so endless in his love, so deep in his character, and so wide in his voice, that we just have to keep searching him and discovering him. It's like you read a bit of the Bible that you've always read for years, and something about it is different, and it speaks to your heart in a way that it's never spoken to you before. That's part of the better story unfolding still in your life. So where are you in regards to that story? Who are you in God's story? Because each of you is a character within it. You're trying to write your own story, but God wants to say, actually, my story is better. Stop writing your own and let me write you into mine. You're like an extra chapter that is never written. And in the end, what you write will be discarded. When it goes to editing at the end of time, your little chapter is ripped out and saying, look, never existed. That was not life. That was not the better story. Or are you like Abraham in that story, and you know that God is actually pulling you towards him today and saying, let me into your life? There's a great image in Revelation of Jesus standing at the door of people's hearts and knocking. And on that door, there's a choice of whether or not we open it. But he wants to come in and give us life. And that's to Christians as well as to those who don't yet know Jesus. Because there's Christians who aren't fellowshipping with Jesus like they should do. They just become religious. And it's just become a mindset and a belief system rather than a relationship. But Jesus today wants to say, look, let me into your heart afresh. Because I'll come and dine with you. We'll have a bit of fun on the way. We'll have some conversation. Or are you like Moses and things have got a little bit derailed, or the life that you thought you were living has just drastically changed? Again, God wants to rewrite you a better story and say, look, he's not finished with you yet. There's always hope. There's always faith, hope and love, because when everything else is gone, they remain. So cling to that today. Let him again step into your heart and begin writing again, something fresh, something new, something better. Or are you on fire for Jesus, thinking, yeah, this is the best decision I've ever made. It's just changing my life. Keep your eyes fixed on Jesus. Don't get distracted by the stuff you're doing or even the person you're becoming. They're all great things to celebrate. But Jesus, get to know him more and more. Don't just read your Bible in little bits. Read it in chunks. Get the story of God written on your hearts afresh. I was just thinking this morning, actually, maybe you're someone who you've got the UCB word for today, and that is your Bible study every day. That's it. A little scripture and what else? Somebody's going to tell you about God. They're helpful, but that's not your relationship with Jesus, because you're living somebody else's relationship as you read what they write about the verses. Read the verses yourself and let God speak to you. Let him write the better story instead of you trying to always live somebody else's story. God is so good like that. And so if the rest of the band can please just come up, and George, still just keep playing gently for us, that'd be great. The rest of the band don't play just yet, but get in position, that'd be fantastic. So I'm just going to invite you to close your eyes, just so you can avoid any distraction. You can just tune into what God is saying to you personally, because the Holy Spirit's moving in this place. He's always moving. He's always working the goodness of Jesus out in our lives. What has Jesus said to you today? How has your heart hopefully been knocked on by Jesus? What is the response that you need to make? And so to the first people, the first kind of people, the Abrahams who are being called from the old way of life into a new way of life, into the way of Jesus for the first time. Maybe you're sensing actually, yeah, there's a little bit of a beating in my heart. There's something that is actually stirring my heartstrings, playing on your heartstrings as it were. Today is a day you can step into God's better story. And you can discover life and life in all its fullness. Because the Bible says that those who have Jesus have life. Those that don't have life. There's only life with Jesus. You think you're living a life, but you're not. Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. There's no way you can know God or know the fullness of life without him. That's the condition. So I want to just invite you, whilst every eye is closed and people are just focusing on what God is saying to them, if you want to say yes to Jesus for the first time today, say, yes, Jesus, I want you to write a better story in my life. I just want you to do a brave thing, just very quickly. You don't have to keep it up, but just hold your hand up so I can come and see you later on and say, well done, you've made the best choice you've ever made. So just give it a few moments. If you want to say, yes, Jesus, I want to step into your better story, where you are now, just put your hand up. And it's your way of saying, yeah, Jesus, on the outside, I'm declaring what's already happened on the inside. I'm inviting you in. Or maybe you're like Moses, who you got a little bit derailed. The stuff that's in your heart has maybe poured out. There's some of the dark stuff, and it's caused a bit of a problem, or there's some of the past has come to bite back. Again, just trust in Jesus. Trust that he is going to write your story again. And just where you are now, just be saying, Jesus, I want to, again, just open my heart to you. I just ask you forgiveness for what I've done, if it's a choice you've made that's caused problems. And step back onto that road that leads to life. And that road is the life of Jesus. Or you're a Christian, and all is good. Just say to Jesus, God, help me keep my eyes fixed on you. You're the author and you're the perfecter of my faith. Help me not to try and perfect it myself through simply good works. Help me not to try and live somebody else's story, but to get into your word and to discover you for myself. Because you've got words that only you want to speak simply to me. There's lines written just for you in God's better story, just for you. There's a certain role just for you. Just ask God to keep showing you that and helping you journey into a life of discovering the more and more of him and what he's got for you. So Father, thank you for Jesus. Thank you that whilst we were still sinners, Jesus died for us. Thank you that he sent Jesus not simply to forgive us and to cleanse us of our wrongdoing, but to actually release us into life, to cause us to step into a relationship with God himself. That Jesus, the cross is all that we need to step into life, because at the cross you paid the price for us. We celebrate that this Easter. And Holy Spirit, I pray for every single heart here that as we celebrate resurrection and your life, that every heart would leave this place more filled with life and resurrection power than they've ever known before. That they came in feeling maybe down. Would you ignite again faith? Would you ignite a fire in their hearts to be passionate about life, about Jesus? Would you give them a hunger for the King and the things of his kingdom? And we ask this in the name of Jesus. Amen. So let's worship this God. Let's worship this Jesus who has written this better story for us. And then we're going to have coffee and stuff upstairs to hang out. If anybody wants to chat more about this better life, please come and grab me at the end. I'd love to pray with you, to encourage you. But let's go out on a high. Let's sing this song with the fullness of our lungs. Let's raise our hands and say, Jesus, we love you. You are our better story. Amen. Amen. Let's stand.